Hi, everyone. Welcome to today's talk. My name is Anu Manchikani Gomez, and I'm an associate professor of social welfare here at the University of California, Berkeley. It's my pleasure and honor to serve as the moderator for today's presentation and to introduce you to my wonderful colleague, who I admire so much, Dr. Tina Sachs. I'm so lucky to have been hired at Berkeley at the same time as Dr. Sachs and been able to share this wild ride that is academia with her over the past 6 years. Dr. Tina Sachs is faculty in the School of Social Welfare. Her scholarly focus is racial inequities in health, social determinants of health, and poverty and inequality, with a focus on the ways that macro structural forces, including structural discrimination and immigration, affect health. Her first book, entitled Invisible Visits, Black Middle-Class Women in the American Healthcare System, was published in 2019. It is a rare examination of the treatment of middle-class women in the healthcare system and demonstrates the ways in which overlapping systems of oppression are animated in healthcare settings and experienced by Black middle-class women. Invisible Visits received the honorable mention for the 2020 Outstanding Social Work Book Award from the Society for Social Work and Research. For her next major project, Dr. Sachs is conducting a study of the direct descendants of participants in the infamous U.S. Public Health Service Tuskegee Syphilis Study. Her other work includes a binational study of migration, labor, and health among indigenous Mexican women in California and Oaxaca, Mexico, as well as a study of gender dynamics and food stamp participation among Latina immigrants in California. Dr. Sachs is also a public scholar, writing for popular media outlets and co-producing documentary films. She embodies what I would call an activist scholar, someone who is always searching for ways for her wonderful scholarship to be influential and to improve the lives of the under-resourced communities that she collaborates with and studies. Prior to her doctoral studies at the University of Chicago School of Social Administration, she spent nearly a decade working for the Federal Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the CDC, where she worked on public health policy with special emphasis in environmental and women's health programs. She also served as the special assistant to the director of the CDC, as well as legislative director of the Baltimore City Health Department and executive director of a nonprofit health organization. So we're all in for a great treat today. So Dr. Sachs, welcome, take it away.
Thank you so much for that generous introduction, and I am so happy to be here and to share with all of you. I'm going to share my screen now. Okay, so what I hope to do in the next 40 or 45 minutes is really take us through what essentially the safety net that we have currently and bring us through a snapshot of the American system. Essentially our American system of poverty, of the programs that we use to ameliorate poverty, and then to take us through what the pandemic has wrought, essentially. So I'll start with where we were before COVID, poverty and the US safety net, and then have us go through what the pandemic has wrought, as I just said. So we know that we're facing an enormous battle right now with evictions, unemployment, hunger, and the looming potential demise of the Affordable Care Act. So that we are really, I would say, at a point of reckoning. And we know we have been at a point of reckoning throughout the summer, a point of racial reckoning. Our democracy stands to be fundamentally changed by what happens in the coming election, the presidential election. And so I want us to think about, where do we go from here? I want to make a couple of points in this talk. One is that the pandemic obviously is an event, a long running event, an ongoing event of enormous significance throughout the world. We in the United States are facing it with a patchwork of different policies and approaches at the state level, at the local level, and at the federal level. And so I want us to think about where we go from here. So I'll talk about the Trump administration and the welfare state. And then I invite us to think about where we can go from here. What can we do? And so although I am going to present data to you this afternoon that I would say is particularly problematic, one might even argue is depressing or saddening, I hope that where we can take this information is to essentially a call to action. And so before we begin with the formal talk, I want to use this framing, the idea, the writer, the amazing writer, Arundhati Roy, who wrote an article recently called The Pandemic is a Portal. And so I want us to just take a little bit of a time here to use Ms. Roy's framing to think about what the pandemic means to us and how we might use it to create a better world, essentially. So I'll play this short video and then jump into the slides.
Whatever it is, coronavirus has made the mighty kneel and brought the world to a halt, like nothing else could. Our minds are still racing back and forth, longing for a return to normality, trying to stitch our future to our past and refusing to acknowledge the rupture. But the rupture exists. And in the midst of this terrible despair, it offers us a chance to rethink the doomsday machine we have built for ourselves. Nothing could be worse than a return to normality. Historically, pandemics have forced humans to break with the past and imagine their world anew. This one is no different. It is a portal, a gateway between one world and the next. We can choose to walk through it, dragging the carcasses of our prejudice and hatred, our avarice, our databanks and dead ideas, our dead rivers and smoky skies behind us. Or we can walk through lightly, with little luggage, ready to imagine another world.
So I hope what I wanted to do there is just sort of invite us to think differently about the data that I'm going to share with you here, and hopefully to inspire us and to use our imagination, to use the energy that we all bring to this world, to think about what it might look like on the other side. So I'm going to bring us through some stats here, and then hopefully at the end, invite us to think about what this portal might do for us. And so instead of thinking of the pandemic only as the devastating event that it is, but perhaps that it can be a window onto a different way of thinking, a different way of acting in the end. So with that, I want to paint a picture for you of what poverty in the United States really looks like, or at least some numbers that demonstrate the scope and depth of poverty. So about 16% of all Californians live in poverty. That's roughly about $24,000 a year for a family of four. And so if you can imagine living in the Bay Area or any area in California, certainly any urban area in California, on that amount of money, that seems to be an absolute impossibility. And so we know that the conditions that people live in poverty are ones of extreme material and really, frankly, emotional and spiritual deprivation, to sort of toil under what it means to survive on so little money. In the United States in general, the official US poverty rate was 10.5%, which is about 34 million people. And that is, I should also say though, that the poverty rate in the United States is an absolute measure of poverty. And so it does not take into consideration where a person lives or a family lives, how expensive it is there. And that the poverty level for each family is actually quite stringent. And so people, there are many, many more people who are living right around the poverty level that are not officially classified as poor. And so so they do not show up in that 34 million people, but nonetheless have very grave challenges with meeting their basic needs. This map simply shows a percentage of people living in poverty around the United States. And so I wanted to show here that there are certain areas of the country in which people, the blue, the purple, indicates they have a higher percentage or a higher rate of poverty for that state. And so you can see that there is this sort of disproportionality in the Southeast here, where you have more people, and also in Kentucky, West Virginia, some other areas of the United States, where you have really 18% or more of the state living in poverty. Much like other elements of the welfare state or of the United States system in general, you see racial disproportionality. And so racial and ethnic minorities, and I should be very clear here to say that these are people who have been characterized as racial or ethnic minorities, classified as such. This is a sort of an aside, but for me, race is really it has social and political meaning, and it's a social and political construction, but it is not a real or biological one. And so even whiteness, or the idea of who's characterized as white, is something that comes up in sort of as a political tool, as opposed to a fundamentally human or biological one. That aside, this chart shows that there is racial disproportionality in who is economically insecure. And so you can see here that white people make up about 62% of the total population, and about 48% of the group of people who are classified as economically insecure. You can also see from this that Black people represent about 12% of the US population and about 18% of the population of the country that is economically insecure. You see also the same disproportionality for Latinx populations and Native populations as well. Child poverty, this is something that I want to linger on just a bit here, and to really point out that children have the highest poverty rate of any group, of any age group in the United States. So people under 18, 16% of all people under 18 lived in poverty in 2018. This is almost 12 million children who lived at or below the federal poverty level in 2018. Given what we know about the long-term and incredibly negative consequences for children who grow up in poverty, we know that growing up in poverty has deleterious consequences for health across the entire life course. Children who grow up in poverty tend to not have great health outcomes, tend to not do very well in terms of even labor market outcomes, and mental health outcomes, et cetera. And so children in the United States are in many ways sort of consigned to a lifetime of challenges because they have grown up in poverty, and because we have so many children who grow up in poverty in the United States. Again, like the other elements of the US system, we see racial disproportionality. And so what this graph illustrates is that fully one third of all Native children and all Black children grow up in poverty. And if you think about the kind of the founding, the origin story of the United States, I think it must be said that the Native children, essentially that this land was, the U.S. was essentially, this is unceded territory, this was stolen land, that these are now descendants of people whose land was taken away from them, and was used essentially in a capitalist machine that was mined through the bodies of enslaved Black people. And so the descendants of these formerly enslaved Black people are now, these Black children are also overrepresented among the ranks of children who grow up in poverty. And I think it is, and certainly two Latino children are almost right there, with fully almost a third of them also growing up in poverty. And so when we think about what we are doing in this country in terms of allowing children to grow up under such material deprivation, and I'll get to hunger and how this has changed, deepened effectively during COVID, I think this is a fairly powerful indictment, a powerful call to action to think about, how do we allow this? Why do we not do something to ameliorate essentially the future of our country? also want to call to our attention here that, you know, over 17 million people, in 2018 actually reported that their family income was below one half of their poverty threshold. So for example, if a family of four, the poverty threshold is about $24,000, a family that is at half of their poverty threshold would be living on less than $12,000 a year. And I just want to point out that this is, 17 million people are living on about half of their poverty threshold. This is an astonishing, staggering, and to me, shameful figure that we as a country essentially allow this to happen. And what I mean by allow it to happen is that we don't intervene in the policy, use the sort of the policy levers that we have, such as income transfers or in-kind benefits, extending or expanding food stamps or housing subsidies, et cetera, that could mitigate the kind of harms that come with living in the depth of poverty that we see in the United States. In terms of the cash assistance safety net, what do we do about families who are living in poverty? What kinds of programs do we have? What do we make of this? What do we do? So we know that this map of the United States shows a previous program that we had in this country called Aid to Families with Dependent Children. This map represents coverage, how many families out of every 100 families with children in poverty were receiving cash benefits under the Aid to Families with Dependent Children program in the mid-1990s. And so the states in blue are states that are covering more of essentially of the eligible families in their states that were receiving cash benefits at that time. So you can see there that, certainly California, Minnesota, other states along in the Northeast were covering more of their families who were eligible for these anti-poverty programs. And right at this time is when Bill Clinton came along and said that he wanted to end welfare as we know it. Very importantly, Bill Clinton did not say that he wanted to end poverty as we know it, but rather to do away with the programs that mitigated poverty. And so what we have here by 2013-14, we see essentially that most states are no longer blue. California has held on to be light blue, meaning that they were serving about 70%, I believe, of the families who were eligible for cash assistance during this time. But all across the country, you see really the erosion of cash benefits for people who were very poor. Another important part of this story is that temporary assistance to needy families actually became a time-limited program, 60 months or 5 years of eligibility. There was a lifetime cap. And so this lifetime cap did not take into consideration whether there would be a pandemic, whether there would be a global recession, what the kind of market factors were that might affect whether someone ended up in poverty for that year or those few months or what. Temporary assistance to needy families also really cemented the importance or codified the importance of work and made that a requirement essentially of receiving cash benefits so that a family or a person would have to do some type of work or search for work and indicate that they were searching for work in order to receive these benefits. This is another part of the American welfare system, which is that work is essential, sort of proving worthiness to receive any kind of benefit is the idea that one would work or that one would be searching for work. In spite of the importance of this, and in spite of these programs, we know that over 40 million people, households in the United States actually struggle with hunger, and that this problem is even more pronounced in rural areas, more so than metropolitan areas, although certainly in urban areas in the United States, we see incredible levels of hunger. one in six families don't have enough food for their children. And so again, here, the idea that we are consigning children to hunger and to, we know that hungry children don't learn very well, don't do very well in school, might have attention problems, that those attention problems might land them perhaps in some sort of disciplinary trouble. And then certainly we know about the racial disproportionality of school discipline, the carceral system in general. And so you can see here the ripple effect and how all of these things are sort of interconnected, the way that we treat people who are economically vulnerable in this country and how the consequences of that ripple throughout the society. The Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, or SNAP, is a program, a very fundamental part of the social safety net in the United States, in which families receive some money. The program in California is called CalFresh, but it is not an incredibly generous program, but it has tended to reduce hunger in families who receive it. So families in California receive about, a single person in California would receive less than $200 a month in food stamps, but they can only make about less than $1,300 a month in income. For a family, a family of four could receive up to $649 a month in food stamp benefits with an income limit of $2,600. And I show this here just to give you a sense that, yes, we have welfare programs, certainly these programs, we have to think about the biggest welfare programs in the United States are actually Social Security, sort of one of our biggest programs, although we don't typically think of it as a welfare program, but it absolutely is. And this is just essentially to say that these programs are relatively stringent in terms of both their income limits and in terms of the cash value that recipients receive. And so now here to shift gears a little bit to thinking about what is going on right now. So I just presented what we had already in terms of poverty, hunger, child poverty, et cetera. And I just wanted us to shift gears here just a bit to show what we are living through right now, an unprecedented, at least in this century, pandemic in which we have, you know, over almost 39 million cases worldwide, certainly, you know, millions of deaths worldwide, over 210,000 people in the United States have died. And the United States is at the top of that sort of dubious distinction there of having the most cases in the world. And so what does this mean for us? What does it do? What has it done? How has the world been remade? Well, obviously we're all here learning all of these new technologies and engaging with each other in a way that we never had to before via Zoom, I think, or other online technologies and platforms. And these can be really good things, but it also has created a particular sense of disconnection for many people, and also economic dislocation. The pandemic has created an economic catastrophe that is in many ways unprecedented. And so we can see here that the United States has had an enormous struggle with unemployment this year. So going all the way up to over 10% unemployment rate in the United States. And this is really, you know, quite unprecedented. And we know that the unemployment rate, again, like everything else in the United States, the ethno-racial minorities bear a disproportionate burden of this economic catastrophe. We also know that over 8 million additional people have slipped into poverty since May, even as particularly as the CARES Act and the aid package has expired, and there's not necessarily movement on providing another one, even though the conditions that people are managing under have not necessarily eased. So just wanted to point out a couple of very important, or I think they're very important, consequences or outcomes of the economic catastrophe, essentially, that the pandemic has brought to us or has caused. And one of them is really the eviction crisis that we are facing. So we know that about 30 to 40 million renters could be at risk of eviction in the coming months. The CDC has called for an eviction moratorium at some point early in the epidemic. I know that there were many, many calls for halts to rent, you know, for a moratorium on rent. But we see here that about 30 to 40 million people might be put out of their homes in terms of renters might be put out of their homes. And this is an enormous amount of people. I mean, this is over, you know, this is about 10% of the population of this country, right? And so we also know through the work of Matthew Desmond in his book, Evicted, that being evicted oftentimes is actually a primary driver of poverty. So it's certainly being evicted is caused by being poor, but it also works the other way, such that Desmond has demonstrated that people who get evicted, it actually leads them into poverty and deepens their poverty, right? Because what happens when you get evicted? First of all, the sort of emotional and mental anguish that causes of not having anywhere to go, ending up potentially homeless or bouncing around, the sort of instability that it causes can be incredibly detrimental, particularly to children, their ability to concentrate, to go to school, even on Zoom. And we know that it actually, you know, the fines and the fees that people that they pay in back rental payments or in housing court or losing their security deposit, all of those things actually lead them into poverty or push them, I should say, into poverty in a way that, you know, that we had not really thought about before. I think Desmond's work really highlights the fact that eviction in many ways is a driver of poverty. And so that now that we're seeing so many people at risk of poverty as a result of COVID, that we really need to think carefully about whether we want this to happen. So I'm going to bring you through just a few snapshots here of what is going on as a most recently, sort of in September of 2020, some surveys that were conducted by the Center for Budget and Policy Priorities and the Census Bureau finds that many people, so one in five people over, you know, 20% of people with children are not caught up on their rent, which means that they are at risk of eviction. That housing insecurity and food insecurity often go together, so that one in seven adults with children did not have enough food for their families and for their children during this period in September. This is really, again, I just, you know, we see these bar graphs and they're sort of sterile and dry, but these are kids, these are our kids that do not have enough to eat in the country with supposedly the most robust, richest infrastructure, wealthiest country, one of the wealthiest countries in the world. Again, major theme that runs through all of this is the racial disproportionality. So Black and Latino households are more likely to suffer food insecurity than white households here. So you can see this disproportionality, these households not having enough to eat. So 18% of Black households not having enough to eat, at least in some point during the month of September. Again, relationship between housing insecurity and food insecurity. So more than 4 in 10 children in households in which the family rents, they either, 27% did not get enough to eat or were not caught up on rent. For 13% of these families, it was both. So there is sort of an economic and there's a precarity that's sort of running through all of this that is certainly we know that people were facing these hardships before, but the pandemic has really deepened these hardships. Same for this. So this actually shows that almost 50% of Black adults had trouble paying for usual household expenses at some for a 1 week period in September of this year. This is a pretty incredible stat. And in fact, if you sort of, you know, across all adults, one in three had a hard time paying for their household expenses since the pandemic began. And here, this is, I think, a very important, a very important and sobering and powerful reminder here that people who are working in low wage jobs, jobs that we could scarcely survive without, people who take care of us, people who serve us food, people who clean up, people who are taking care of our loved ones, LPNs, nurses, et cetera, people who are really sort of clustered in these low wage labor markets have seen the biggest job losses, right? And so these are people who are already vulnerable, who can scarcely afford this kind of contraction in the low wage labor market because there is very little safety net. People have very little savings. And so we see here that the pandemic has really deepened existing inequities and existing material deprivation that I think we should obviously be concerned about. And just to make the point here, so thinking about housing, food stamps, other forms of the safety net, we really have to also consider and very strongly consider that healthcare is absolutely a component of the safety net and the welfare state more generally. And the potential end of the Affordable Care Act or Obamacare, it has enormous ripple effects through not just people who are on the Affordable Care Act, but for people who, for all people in the United States, because it has implications for people who are on employer-sponsored coverage. So ending the ACA essentially means that 21 million people would lose their coverage. 133 million people who have pre-existing conditions would also lose the protection, the right to not be discriminated against simply because they perhaps have asthma or perhaps they have, or because they have had COVID. All of those things previous to the Affordable Care Act would have made one eligible to be discriminated against, essentially to be excluded from healthcare insurance or to have to pay incredibly high premiums for that insurance. And so these protections would end for 133 million people and 21 million could lose their coverage altogether. Very important part of the welfare state here, the safety net that would be eroded, that stands to be decimated, if frankly, is that 12 million adults who are on Medicaid. So the Affordable Care Act actually expanded Medicaid, expanded the categorical eligibility of Medicaid to adults who were previously in certain categories who were ineligible for Medicaid previously. It expanded coverage to those adults. And this coverage could end for more than 12 million low-income adults. And these are adults who are making just a little bit above the federal poverty level. So they would be making about 133% of the federal poverty threshold. So not very much money. And these adults stand to lose coverage if the Affordable Care Act goes away. 800,000 people who are getting treated for their opioid addiction through Medicaid, that coverage would end. 2 million people 26 and under who are covered under their parents' coverage, that coverage would go away. And so what does this mean now in the age of Trump? What has Trump done to the Trump administration, done to the safety net? What are some of the implications of the Trump administration? So essentially the Trump administration has tried to sort of reinstate or to use the idea that everyone who receives some sort of benefit through the welfare state must be working. They have used executive orders to try to expand the requirement that people work. They have done this in, although this is already a sort of an enduring part of the American welfare system, the emphasis on work. The Trump administration has really made it a particular strategy to use executive orders to try to re-emphasize work and to strip coverage or eligibility from people if they are not working. So they have encouraged their secretaries to use it to write in regulations into existing social safety net programs that require people to work. And so you might be thinking, well, does that seem so bad, right? I have to work. Everybody should have to work, perhaps, to get some sort of coverage. Unfortunately, it turns out that for people, for example, on Medicaid, so Kentucky actually implemented this work requirement under the Trump administration. And it turns out that requiring people to work doesn't have a very positive effect on people's well-being. And so people who, because for example, many people who are getting healthcare through Medicaid have conditions that make it very difficult for them to work, and they actually need their health insurance to manage those conditions so that they can work. So that if the requirement is that you must work before you get your health insurance, it actually turns out that many people are unable to work because they don't have healthcare. And so this is what we are seeing, is sort of the erosion. I think to call it an erosion is to put it kindly. I would say that in many ways, this is sort of a bludgeoning of the welfare state under the Trump administration. Although we have seen this kind of pulling back or, you know, taking away of benefits and the protections of the safety net for years in this country, certainly under both Democratic and Republican leadership. Another very important and troubling change that the Trump administration has put forward is the sort of expanding the idea of being a public charge. This is sort of a part of his extreme antipathy toward immigrants, both legal and undocumented immigrants in this country. The public charge rule essentially says that if anyone any immigrant partakes or uses any social safety net program, that would exclude them from ever being able to become lawful permanent residents or U.S. citizens. This has particular implications for people in mixed status families, for whom, if they have a child that might be eligible for a state children's health insurance program, they might be afraid to enroll that child in that program for fear that the child later, for fear that there might be some reprisals for themselves to be able to go ahead and become a legal permanent resident or U.S. citizen at some point in the future. And so this has gone back and forth in the courts a fair amount. And I think that as recently as August of this year, that the court finally said that the administration can go ahead and implement this rule. So this is, again, part of a very orchestrated and comprehensive strategy, anti-immigrant strategy that the Trump administration has used. And this one has very clear consequences for safety net programs in particular, can have dire implications for people who might be able to get health insurance through a public program at this time of COVID. Certainly, these changes could harm public health, particularly with the state children's health insurance programs that are available to U.S. citizen children of non-citizen parents. Particularly during a pandemic, you really have to think about what is the real purpose of these kinds of rules? What is the point? Who does it serve? Who does it harm? And why is this still going on? So we do know that almost 7 million children have at least one non-citizen parent are enrolled in Medicaid or the state children's health insurance program, and they're at high risk for losing their coverage. And some estimates suggest that these children, you know, there might be a drop of between 15% and 35% of these kids. So between 875,000 and 2 million kids might end up without insurance, health insurance, as a result of this public charge rule. So what does this mean? What do we do? How do we think about where we go from here? I think that what, for me, as someone who's really been interested in this and engaged in this work for a long time, I think that it seems as though poverty in the United States is a sort of an enduring fixture of advanced capitalism. And I think the question is really, does it have to be? Do we have to allow this to continue? Particularly now that we see that COVID has both, you know, deepened and expanded the hardship that many people in the United States are facing. The Trump administration certainly has extended its attacks on both immigrants and the safety net writ large, but these are not, I would say, sort of the intensity of these attacks has ratcheted up under Trump. But there is an ongoing kind of American antipathy toward what we typically think of as welfare. We don't typically think about, for example, mortgage tax deductions for people who buy homes. We don't think about that as welfare, even though that is an incredible transfer of a cash transfer to middle and upper class people that the U.S. government forgoes in tax revenue. We don't think about that as being welfare, but it absolutely is. It's just welfare for non-poor people, essentially. So we know that what is going on in this country right now is an extension of kind of a larger project. But I think that particularly in an election year, we really have to think about the implications for democracy. What does it mean when so many people struggle to meet their basic needs? Can all of us really participate equally in a democratic society? Can all of us participate in it as we fight to maintain a democratic society? Can we do that when so many of us are hungry? And how do we think about that? How do we feel about that? What does that call us to do? But I want to say that, again, to bring back the words of Arundhati Roy and to other scholars like Ruha Benjamin, who talk about, and Ruha Benjamin inscribes her books with "Another World is Possible." I really want us to think creatively, use our imagination, our intuition, our spirit, our feeling of interdependence with our fellow humans, and to think about what Cornel West says, which is that justice is what love looks like in public. How do we think about this? What can we do? How can we think and act collectively? And so I know that there are many examples of resistance where people are pushing back against what they see as injustice all over the world. And obviously in the United States, we have seen a groundswell of activism and action and people coming together, even in spite of the challenges of COVID. And so I think there is absolutely hope here, but that we really need to get together and work toward a common good. And so I just wanted to call out a couple of these things that I see as promising, and then I'm going to close up for questions here. And so one of the things, for example, is something called a universal basic income, which is, there's a demonstration project of this, which is going on in Stockton, California. Universal basic income is actually an old idea, or it's not a new idea, I guess I should say, that at least, you know, even Martin Luther King talked about providing universal basic income to people with the idea that we are worthy of being able to meet our basic needs simply by virtue of being human, as opposed to sort of a capitalist model in which the only reason that you are worthy is because of what you produce. So the idea of tethering all benefits in the social safety net program to work really sort of presupposes that you are only as good as your ability to work. And that presents particular problems, obviously, for the way we think about, first of all, what counts as work. Care work is often taken out of that equation. The work that people who identify as women often do, that is often not considered proper work. People who are disabled are often considered not able to work properly and then therefore not able to take part in the society in a way that is considered functional or appropriate. Similarly to the way we think about people who are older, who are no longer working, and that we can sort of just sort of discard them, much in the same way that Trump has talked about, well, you know, COVID only affects old people, so who cares? The universal basic income projects are really, they're a very material, concrete intervention, and they're also really a philosophical one. They essentially say you are worthy of having a certain amount of income per month to do with, you know, whatever you need to do with it without any means testing, without someone coming to your door and asking to see receipts. You are simply worthy of having a sort of a modicum of an income floor simply by virtue of being human. And so this is why that there are these universal basic income projects that are cropping up all over the place. They are certainly fraught. There are many people who don't agree with them. That is kind of a conversation for another time. But there are things that we might be able to do. And certainly the universal basic income project in Stockton actually was extended. It was supposed to end a few months ago, but when the pandemic hit, the project was extended at least until January of this coming year, which is not too much more time, only a couple of months. There are things that we can do. We can be in community together, and we can make these interventions, and we can, I think, use the pandemic as a portal to remake our world and to essentially envision a different world, to use our imagination, our creativity, and our sense of connectedness to heal each other and support each other. So with that, I'm going to close and take questions. Thank you so much.
Hey, thank you so much for that wonderful presentation, Dr. Sachs. So I would invite the audience to please add your questions to the chat on Facebook, and I will be reading them for Dr. Sachs. We have about 10 more minutes. So there's a question from Ben de Guzman. What's the relationship between the statistics regarding eviction you showed before and the moratorium on evictions that may or may not be in place locally? These are in place and or enforced unevenly, right? Are the statistics that you shared affected by the moratoria?
So those were statistics about people who might have been at risk, given how, you know, perhaps being behind on some rent payments. And so the moratoria is essentially to say to these landlords, like, please do not evict people, do not sort of put the whole, you know, law enforcement apparatus in place to enforce these evictions. And so certainly places their evictions are unevenly, they've always been unevenly enforced. But I think the CDC recommendation is just that. I don't necessarily think that it has any teeth. It's just saying that we should not be evicting people because that will cause additional hardship. I do have some suggestions for further reading. I mean, certainly much of Matthew Desmond's work, I would suggest, so Evicted, as well as some of his other policy briefs where he really lays out both the empirical and the theoretical foundation for his work. I would start there.
Do you have any suggestions for readings regarding any of the other content you've covered for folks who are just becoming familiar with the welfare state beyond the eviction recommendation? What would you assign?
Oh my gosh, that's a good question. I mean, I would sort of, I think I certainly always go back to some of the works that kind of lay out the welfare state more generally. And so there's a book by Michael Katz. I use it all the time and I cannot think of the name of it. but I would suggest that. I can look that up really quickly and put that in the chat. I also like, there are some scholars of the welfare state that write together a lot, SOSS, S-O-S-S, and SRAM, and they are pretty critical scholars of the welfare state that I would suggest reading. And yeah, that's where I would sort of start, I guess.
Okay, great. I'm going to ask a question now, if you don't mind. So it's possible that we'll have a new president in January. I'm holding my breath personally, but it's possible. Let's imagine that we are. So after living through the past 4 years and so many of these rules and orders that you have mentioned that the Trump administration has put into place, you know, I think if we had to change an administration, we could expect that some of these things would go away. But even undoing those, right, it doesn't really change the fundamental skeleton of the welfare state and it, you know, the inequality it's founded on and that it perpetuates. So in your imagining the world anew, that we had a government that would allow us to do that, what are your sort of hopes in thinking through this near possible future and what are your cautions?
Ooh, that's a really good question. So I would, you know, I really struggle with that in so many ways because I really go back and forth between kind of an incremental approach to writing some of these challenges and one that is much more sweeping. I think Americans do not really have a stomach for change that is more foundational. But I really actually think that that's what it requires. I don't really think that a lot of the sort of incrementalism can work, but I guess if I were working within the constraints of what I think is sort of the kind of political bandwidth or latitude that we have, I mean, certainly any ability to reinstate or expand Medicaid, I think is huge. I think if we could do that, we would be doing something quite important. I think that it could have implications for all kinds of, you know, sort of cross-cutting communities, right? Could have implications for mental health care, substance use, reproductive rights, disability rights, so many things. And I think I would really like to see that if we could do that to both kind of to provide some more funding to Medicaid because it is chronically underfunded, to allow for the state to provide for access to all a full range of reproductive health services under Medicaid would be huge. And then we know that Medicaid actually is a provider of all kinds of in-home health services for people with disabilities that keeps them in the community as opposed to being in institutions. And so I just think Medicaid is just an absolutely critical part of the welfare state that we don't do very much. People are working on it all the time, but it's sort of out of the kind of public imagination of what a welfare state really is. And so that would be one place I would focus some attention.
Great, thank you. Okay, so we have some more questions from the audience. Christian Joshua Guerrero says, thanks, Professor Sachs. We've seen reports that Black and Latino populations have been disproportionately affected by COVID, both health and economic impacts. What responses have you seen that have been effective? Any CBO responses that were highly effective?
Yeah, I think, I mean, one thing I feel like I'm sort of observing is that people are moving toward trying to think about health from a more comprehensive perspective. So taking back the idea of health and wellness as something that is not necessarily, that you can't necessarily get in the healthcare encounter, but that needs to be given in perhaps in a community setting, not given, but worked on worked on in community. And so I know in the Bay Area, there are some, certainly some community-based health organizations that are doing amazing work. There are some things happening in Chicago too, where organizations are trying to target communities that are disproportionately represented among people who have COVID and trying to do a lot of education, do a lot, you know, more support, giving out food, checking on people, et cetera. So I think there are definitely some community responses to this, as well as I've seen some mutual aid responses popping up so that we, you know, we don't have to use any kind of state or government apparatus, but that we rely on one another and try to help each other through this as well.
I think this somewhat relates to the next question. What do you think the role is of cooperatives in creating more equity and security for people?
So like healthcare cooperatives, I'm wondering if that.
I'm not sure. You know, there's many, right? There's different types of cooperatives, but I'm not sure.
I'm not sure what that exactly is referring to, but I think it's sort of, it's reminding me a little bit of, you know, what we were just talking about, of sort of mutual aid, of people coming together and saying, like, what do you need? Do you need food? Do you need a ride? Do you, so forth. I know that there are some organizations in the Bay that are doing like a lot of healing work. Well, this was pre-COVID, so I don't know in terms of being able to do that in the, you know, during the epidemic, but people were coming together and essentially swapping services or bartering their services. So massage therapists, Reiki healers, you know, traditional healers coming together and sharing services and supporting each other in that way. So I can absolutely see that continuing if it can be done in a way that's, you know, socially distanced. I don't know.
Right. Okay. So I don't think we have any more questions from the audience. Is there anything else you wanted to share before we concluded?
No, I just hope that we can, we can change this. We can disrupt this. I think we can. So I just want to hopefully that we end on a note of action as well, because I think these are sort of moral questions that, you know, I presented them as data questions in some respects, but these are moral questions to me. And I hope that we can be on the right side of that history.
Absolutely. Thank you. And I wrote down the words from R&W Boys, the video that you showed earlier, and hope that everyone can, as you asked us to do, rethink the doomsday machine and imagine our world anew and actually do something to make it so, right? So, yeah. So thank you so much, Dr. Sachs, for this wonderful presentation. And thank you for everyone in the audience who attended today.
Thank you, Dr. Gomez. Thanks, everyone.